pathologist from Providence Public Schools Department and co-founder of the nonprofit practice Access Speech Therapy. She graduated with a degree in Communication Sciences and Disorders from the Massachusetts General Hospital Institution of Health Professions in 2016. Before she became an SLP, she worked as an evolutionary biologist and got a Ph.D. in genetics from Stony Brook University. In her practice, Stephanie provided client-focused therapy to individuals with autism, CP, fluency disorders, language delays, aphasia, and other communication disorders. Stephanie works with individuals and families to develop functional, attainable therapy goals.
Thank you. Hi, everybody. My name is Stephanie Izzi, and I'll introduce myself one more time, a little bit more detail. This is what I do all day is teach people how to communicate, help them communicate, support them to communicate. This is who I focus on the most right now. That's my son Theo, he's a year old. That's my niece Jackie, she's two. She has no trouble communicating at this point. And I work for Access Speech Therapy. So a little bit about my background. I did not always want to be a speech language pathologist. I went a crazy route. I studied genetics and worked in a lab and didn't talk to people a lot until I was in my mid-20s. And then I got involved with teaching and ended up being involved in a program called the Center for Communicating Science. It was started by Alan Alda, who was in MASH. I don't know if anyone knows who that is, but he recently got diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. But he was really passionate about communicating really complicated ideas to people who don't study science. And that was really cool. I worked with a lot of, I took a lot of public speaking courses, and I worked with a lot of people in the engineering department and physics. And as it turns out, a lot of them were diagnosed with autism. Like, there's a handful of them that actually have communication disorders. My sister became a speech language pathologist from a music major, so she went straight to speech language pathology, and she asked me to help her study for her exams because she was not quite as involved in grad school as I was. So when I was reading papers to try to help her learn about the field of speech language pathology, I was like, this is a really cool field. You can get a job, which in science you can't always get a job that pays you well. And you're helping people do a really fundamental thing. So just for those who don't know, is there anyone here who wants to be a speech pathologist? Cool, I like it. But we work in a lot of different fields. There's a ton of areas that you can work in as an SLP. Swallowing, cognitive functions, but I ended up focusing a lot on the speech and language portion of it, which is the bulk of it. And my goal is really to ensure quality of life through functional communication. So what does that mean? So communication, just to give you an overview, it requires a motivation to communicate. You have to want to tell a partner something, relay some information. You have to be able to formulate a message in some way. You have to have a partner to communicate with, so if you're alone in a room, you're not really communicating. They have to be able to receive the message and understand it. I firmly believe that communication is a fundamental human right. And I also believe that all humans, regardless of age or capacity, have the potential to communicate in some way. So that's something you kind of have to believe if you're going to be a speech language pathologist, and I haven't found anything to tell me that's not true. So I work in the public school system, in preschool mostly. I give therapy to a range of students. But in my private practice, we are really focused on creating individualized therapy plans for kids and adults with communication disorders. We provide support and training to everyone who works with those people because, I don't know, in the school setting, you see your students for half an hour a week. I've worked with people I've seen up to three times a week, but I don't live with these people. I'm not their only communication partner. So I really want to stress that everyone involved with the care of a client should be on the same page with their communication. And the other thing is, we try, one of our mission statements is to make the world a more accessible place for people with communication disorders and other kinds of disorders, because it's really not designed for people who aren't the typical human being. And it can be. So I'll just go through our missions, and then I kind of want to reach out and see what you guys want to know and what you do. But first, access speech therapy creates individualized therapy plans because there isn't any profile that can kind of encompass any particular disorder. There's a whole bunch of factors that are going to affect your treatment plan for a person, what their goals are, the approach you're going to use, what's going to be successful for them. So again, we work with people who have language delays, autism, cerebral palsy, apraxia of speech, other speech disorders, stuttering, a variety of communication disorders. I'm going to use autism as my example because that's a lot of what I work with. So if you don't know, to get an autism diagnosis, you have to essentially have two main areas of dysfunction, one in social communication, and then you either have to have like a restricted interest or stereotypical behaviors. So you can probably picture in your mind someone who you can think of that has a diagnosis of autism. But there's a lot of research out there on comorbidities, so other things that co-occur in people who have the autism diagnosis. The biggest ones that I've seen, intellectual disability is one. ADHD is another one, and anxiety is another one. OCD is something that people with autism often show signs of. Mood disorders, sleep disorders, gastrointestinal disorders. There's all kinds of things that are influencing how someone with autism is functioning. And this is a comic strip written by someone who has Asperger's diagnosis, which doesn't exist anymore, but when you hear autism spectrum, this is what she says people often think of, that you're either not autistic, a little bit autistic, really, really autistic. And she prefers to think of it in sort of this group of symptoms kind of way. I really like this image of, for anyone, you are a combination of deficits and skills, and you have strengths and weaknesses in different areas. And someone who is neurodiverse in some areas of function will be typical in other areas, or above average in some areas. So it's less of a spectrum and more of a person that you're working with to support them. So how do you create an individualized approach to therapy? First, to identify the goal. So it has to be developmentally appropriate, individually appropriate, attainable, and most of all, functional. So if your goal is to have someone let you know when they need to go to the bathroom, that's functional. They will need to tell you that if you're going to work with that person. If you want them to tell you what color the pictures on the wall are, that might not be the most functional goal. You know, you can make them do it. You can train a person to respond in a certain way, but you have to kind of think, is that going to be functional? Is that going to help them in their life? Then you identify the strengths that you can leverage to help them attain that goal, the needs that you're going to have to overcome to support them in attaining that goal, and you're going to set up functional, naturalistic activities to practice the strategies that you come up with to support reaching that goal. So I like to say it's kind of like what I used to do in a science field. You form a hypothesis and then you test it. So you say, I think this is going to work. Let's try it out and see if that's the way to go. So I'll give you some examples. This was a student I worked with who had a diagnosis of autism, and he really had some stereotypical interests. He liked numbers. You can't really see it, but that coloring page, it's all numbers. He wrote them down. If you hand him a crayon and a paper, he writes down numbers. If you give him Play-Doh, he makes numbers. And he'll point out any number he sees in the hallway. So this is a child who really likes numbers. That's his thing. And he was in a preschool, so the goal that was written for him was, we'll use 3 to 4 words to communicate with, you know, peers and adults. That's not attainable in a year He didn't say any other words but numbers. So I rewrote that goal to say he will use a total communication approach to meet basic wants and needs, and will tolerate peers playing near him. So he's someone, if a child or adult touched any of those numbers, he would be very upset, because those are his numbers and he made the numbers. And in 3 months, he was letting other students touch numbers, play with him with numbers, as long as they were talking about numbers, he was good with letting other kids play near him. So for other, you know, a lot of people use visual supports to help them if they can't use verbal words. We use a lot of pictures. I don't know if you guys use pictures in what you do, probably have a lot of visual supports, which is great. It's kind of like one of those go-to tools for speech pathologists, like use a visual. I worked with another client who was an adult with autism who was blind. So visuals were out. He ended up using an iPad where he could select, that it would say each word in his vocabulary on the iPad. It would say each word in a female voice, and then when he selected it, it was a male voice, so it was his voice, and it was a really cool solution to a challenge that was kind of not what we're used to working with. So you have to really look at the whole person when you're creating goals and strategies. The second thing we do as a company is provide support and training for caregivers and professionals who work with people who are neurodiverse, who have communication disabilities and the like, because again, that's the world that they're living in, so they need to function in that world. We have three things I'll just mention. Hannon certifications, if you haven't heard of the Hannon program. It was developed in Canada. It's really cool. I'll talk about it a little bit. But it trains parents and caregivers and has some teacher trainings to support language development in a naturalistic way for kids 0 to 5, 6. In Providence, they're rolling out something, and in the Midwest, they have a lot of these programs called the Itinerant Early Childhood Special Education Model, which basically your specialists, so PT, OT, resource teachers, special educators, are going in and working with general education classroom teachers to train them in how to support and differentiate their instruction so that kids with disabilities can be in the general education classroom, which is a huge thing. You know, ideally, I think every child could be in a general education classroom with the right supports. And then we do some professional development for teachers and doctors and other healthcare professionals around working with people with communication disorders. So this is probably really hard to see for you guys, but the Hannon program has developed some strategies, and they're really, really research-based. So they have a heavy research base. They put a lot of money into creating really effective programming, and they change it as the research changes. But they offer really nice, simple ways for parents to learn to communicate with. They have a program for autism and language delay. And it's basically looking at how to interact with your child and motivate them to want to communicate. So that's the overall goal for Hannon programming, is not to train your child to talk. They literally, one of their mantras is, do not use the word say. So if you're asking someone, say this, say this, say this. If I ask you, like, hey, are you a communication major? Say yes. Like, that's not a, we're not communicating. I'm just telling you what to tell me, and you can respond, I'm sure. So they really push for the naturalistic, you know, leveraging of a child's strengths to get them to want to communicate. And it really is, theoretically, the best practice to train people who work with your clients every day to get the strategies that you're using, because then they can practice throughout the day. Your half hour with your client isn't going to change them as quickly as you know, an entire day of therapy, essentially. So that is something that we really strive to do, is teach everyone involved with someone's life the strategies that they're using to communicate. So my favorite example of this is a recent student I worked with who, he was on the spectrum. He's 4 and a half. He wasn't using any words to communicate, but he was, you know, they had done some training. He was really well behaved. The parents were super involved. And I said, okay, we're going to use a total communication approach. So what that means is, I give them pictures, I give them sign language, I give them gestures, I give them the words, and see what they're responding to and what they're using to communicate. So he really liked playing with blocks and a trampoline. So we had a picture of a trampoline, we used the sign for jump, we used more, and we would kind of set up situations where he wanted to use the trampoline, but he would have to ask. And he wanted nothing to do with the sign. We could go behind him and make him do the sign, but he didn't really pick up on that. After a couple of sessions, it was clear that he was handing us pictures. So we're like, all right, we got him a picture book. Great. So he had a picture book for all the things he really wanted to ask for, and he was starting to use it, and it was beautiful. And his mom would come to all the sessions, and we taught her how to use the picture book and how to, you know, prompt him to respond with the picture book. And I'm talking her through it. So we have our parents stay in the sessions with our students, and we train them to do the therapy, essentially. So mom was excited. You know, her child was now using a picture to communicate. And I could tell this one day we were working, and he was beautifully using the whole sentence, "I want eggs." We were doing the plastic eggs, and it was great. And he was handing over the pictures, and I'm like, this is great progress. He's really, you know, handing over all these pictures, but I could tell there was something going on in mom's mind. She wasn't super thrilled. And I was like, just so you know, it's not that we're working on, you know, the ultimate goal is always if a child can speak, you know, the more naturalistic way to get a child to speak, the better. So if a child is going to be able to speak, that's our ultimate goal. The supports, the picture supports aren't in, they're not replacing speech. They're supporting language, so that's kind of the goal. And this probably will never happen again, but as I said that, her son pointed to each word in this picture strip and said, "I want eggs." And she burst into tears. I mean, it was amazing. So the kids started talking, and after that, in 2 weeks, she had been using it at home, she'd been using it with all of her family. The grandmother learned how to use the communication book, his brother used the communication book. It took what I've worked years with clients and not gotten the success, for him 3 months of that, and he was speaking in full sentences with his book. I mean, he takes his book everywhere. He points to the pictures. It took away that anxiety of speech. It was motivating for him. It allowed him to make sense of the world, and it was really cool. So now he organizes his own picture book. And so this, our third kind of arm of our mission statement in access speech therapy, is making the world a more accessible place. So it's cool if you can get your clients to be cured of whatever their disability is, if they are 100% better and, you know, everyone's typical and we're all functioning the same. But that's not always possible, and it's great that we have a diverse planet that we live on. But the world is designed by neurotypical people and physically able people and tall people. I know, like, it's not designed for a lot of differences. So we want to, there's easy things that you can change to make it accessible for a variety of people. And this just points out nicely, like, equality is give everyone a box. Equity is allow everyone to see over the fence. And then accessibility is, like, why not just put a chain link fence? It's easy, everyone can see through it. Like, it's not hard. Always. Sometimes it is, but usually it's not really that hard. So there's two kind of areas where universal design, you probably have heard of if you're working, you will if you haven't. But it is really a principle that came out of architecture. So it was designing buildings to be used by the greatest number of people. So smooth surfaces, don't use stairs, use ramps so that wheelchairs can get up them. There's, if you look in the deaf community, there's ways to make it accessible for deaf students. You know, you can look up all these principles of architectural design that make buildings easier to access for people with a variety of abilities. There's also a movement for universal design and learning, which, since I work with a lot of school-age children, I am interested in. So It really looks at how we represent what we're teaching, how we allow students to express what they've learned, and how we motivate them to want to learn. So we work on motivating students to, in their own way. You know, if you're neurodiverse, you're going to have different motivations than someone who's really great at reading and just wants to read. We worked with a choir to make their music accessible to a variety of people, including young children and people with sensory needs and people on the spectrum and people with physical disabilities. So we had a sensory room set up, and essentially all it took was allowing, you know, they stood up at the beginning of the concert and they said, if you need to yell or move around, you know, go ahead. We're not gonna stop, and we're not gonna look at you funny because your kid's yelling or moving or whatever. And that was enough for a lot of people to come and enjoy a concert that they would have felt very awkward and had to leave with their kid or their child with autism or their friend with dementia. I mean, they had a lot of people there that enjoyed an hour-long concert that really wouldn't have. In the classroom, I had a client who, they told her mother that she couldn't spell. They're like, she's not learning spelling. We teach her, and she's just not writing it. She won't spell. We don't think she can spell. Like, that was the lesson. All of her homework for spelling looked like this. You put the homework in front of her, and you would literally have to take her hand and trace the letters. She would just shut down. She didn't want, you know, she was done, wouldn't. But her mom was like, I think she's reading, because she would say things, you know, just she had an inkling that this kid was reading. Her child was diagnosed with autism, really liked art. So I said, okay. We let her color for a while, and she drew a picture of a dog, and I said, you need to sign your art. So she wrote her name, and I said, and you need to tell everyone who comes in here what that is, because it's beautiful and I want them all to know. So she spelled the word dog. She didn't write it on the paper with her pencil, but if you give her a marker, I mean, I love that. She used the face as an O. And if you're a classroom teacher who's assessing a child for spelling, do they have to use a pencil? She could also spell beautifully with Play-Doh. She would roll out the letters and form them and spell all kinds. You could ask her to spell a lot of words and she would spell them out with Play-Doh. Why do you have to make a kid do it the way you want them to do it? If you're really, if you're assessing handwriting, I guess you gotta use a pencil. If you're assessing spelling, she spelled dog, so great. And just one last thing quick before I open it up to any questions or comments. One of the reasons I'm so passionate about universal design for learning, this is my husband and the father of Theo. He's a pretty cool dad and uncle. He's a teacher and he graduated with a degree in material science, so he's a pretty smart guy. But he spent up until grade 6 in a secluded special education classroom because that's the way they did it in the 80s. You know, he's a smart guy, he had ADHD and maybe some Asperger's stuff going on. It didn't function the way the world functioned, but you know, so he spent a good long time outside of the mainstream classroom, and he's got some not so nice things to say about that. So I'm glad we're moving in the right direction for special education, but it's really important because you'd miss out on a lot of cool people if we just kind of put everyone in a classroom and let them sit there for a while. So I have some more slides, but I'd like to open it up to you guys. If you have any questions, comments, tell me what you guys do, what you think. Ideas about making restaurants more accessible? Yeah.
I mean, I'm just thinking about, like, personally, like, I feel like a specific Italian restaurant, like, I'm thinking about, like, I have trouble reading sometimes the words. And I always ask, like, the waiter or waitress, I'm like, how do you, like, say this? Because I don't want to say it wrong.
Right.
So, like, maybe, like, I'm thinking about, like, friendlies, like, how those pictures to be more adaptable. So maybe taking that into account with specific restaurants, because people shouldn't be afraid to go to restaurants due to the fact that they don't have maybe pictures or, like, the braille or stuff like that.
Right. So I work with a lot of clients who want to order food out. It's, or think, like, I don't know, I like ordering out at restaurants, but like imagine if you couldn't go to any fast food restaurant or supermarket, like, you'd have to rely on one person to get all of your food, and they might not know what you like, and you can't tell that. Like, it would be really frustrating for me, who likes to eat a lot. But I was at a McDonald's, and there was a gentleman in front of me who had clearly had a stroke at some point. And he was trying to order, and no one could understand what he was saying. And the person, I mean, you know, it's a young person at the counter who just is working at a McDonald's and probably just wasn't thinking about it, but he kept trying to order, and the kid was getting really frustrated, saying, like, I don't know what you want. They have picture menus in the back of the restaurant. Most fast food places will have a picture menu in the back of your restaurant. But if you need a picture menu, you probably can't ask for the picture menu. So maybe just thinking about, hey, I should go get this guy a picture menu. And we give a lot of our clients who are working on that, obviously, a book they can learn to find pictures. I don't know how many people you guys work with in this program with communication disorders. Can you think of any examples? Does anyone have anyone in particular that they want to ask about, tell a story about, that they're working with?
I just know, like, a lot of kids can only say, like, a few words, so, like, I don't know what my question is, but, like, how would you be able to, like, not, it's case by case, I guess, but, like, how would you, like, one word, I feel like, has so many meanings
for
some kids, so, like,
yeah.
How do you determine, like,
my favorite example is the word more, which everyone teaches, like, as the first word, and then kids use it for literally everything. And my son, like I said, I would never do this, but my son knows more, and he asks for more everything. And it's great, because it does have a variety of uses, but, like, sometimes he doesn't mean more, he means a different one, he means, like, so you have to kind of, getting trained in science. So take your research class really seriously is what I will say, because what you do as a clinician and a therapist a lot of the time, to do it really well, you do hypothesis testing. So you're like, okay, this kid has three words. How is he communicating? So maybe he's not using words, but he's looking at something. Or a lot of my students like to ask, so if you've known any child on the spectrum, they might do something like this, is what I see a lot. What color is that? What color is that? What color is that? And you can tell them the color, but they want you to ask them. So they'll go, what color is that? And they want you to say, what color is that, to them, so that they can tell you that they know what color that is. But what they're trying to, so figuring out the motivation for what they're communicating is really important. So in my mind, a lot of the times what those kids are communicating is, that's how I can interact with an adult. Like, okay, I know that when they ask me that question, I can answer it and their faces light up. And, like, think about the response you're giving. You're rewarding that communication. So you're asking the question, they can answer it, they know what the answer is, and they're really excited. So you build in, and it takes a long time, but you build in those ways of giving them that fulfillment without having you have to ask them that question 18 times so they can tell you it's red 18 times. So you can give them scripts, you can give them a picture to point to, you can play a game. So we use a lot of play scripts to have kids on the spectrum interact with other kids. Once they learn what they're supposed to say to get the interaction, they usually are really happy. They really want to interact with these other kids. It's just the world doesn't make sense to them in the same way it does to typical kids. So you kind of have to figure out where they're coming from and try to access it on their level, if that makes any sense. Anybody else? Yeah.
So I've been with a couple of kids who, like, it's kind of the opposite, where they don't know how to communicate something. Recently, the little girl we have now, she was doing something, and you can, like, see it in her face where, like, she didn't like it, and then, but, like, they won't say, like, oh, I don't want to do this or something, so it's, like, you have to, like, read them.
Yes.
And, like, how would you deal with that? Because, like, you could tell she didn't like it, and you're like, oh, like, she's, like, we're, like, do you want to keep doing this? She's, like, no, I'm really scared. And, like, they won't say it themselves, so that sometimes it's
right.
Hard to, like, realize that.
And there's a fine line, because you don't want them to rely on on you realizing it, you want to give them a way to say it, but, and sometimes you do have to do stuff that you don't want to do. So there are programs that you can look up. There's really good techniques out there for giving people what's called internal state language. So like training them to recognize how they're feeling and then being able to identify it and then being able to communicate that to you. It's kind of three different steps. But the first step is training them to identify it. So we talk about the basics. I don't have any good images of this, but if you, you know, you've seen those charts in hospitals that are like, how do you feel today? And it's a range of the smiley faces. That's pretty vague. So I usually start with, I'm hungry, you know, like at lunchtime, you can say, are you feeling hungry? Like, just to talk about what it feels like to be hungry or cold, like qualities of things that are physical. So you can say, oh, this is cold and you feel cold and this is hot and you feel hot. Like, give them that language first in pictures, verbally, all of those things. Pictures are a great one if you can see. pictures are a good support. And that script of, oh, you don't like it, you can, you know, here's what you can say. You can say, I don't like that, I need a break, a lot of break area things. And again, there's some behavior techniques out there. I work with, I consult with ABA therapists about, and behavior therapists, about kind of how to balance between, I'm avoiding work and I really don't like this. So it depends on where your kids are at. But that is what I would suggest, is looking up things on internal state language, because there's really good techniques to provide kids with that language. That's hard. That's hard for adults, but it's especially hard for kids, because that's way more abstract than, like, this is the color red, or I want a hamburger. You know, it's very abstract, and it requires some, like, self-reflection and complicated language. So, but there are ways to do it. It's a really common question and a good question. And it's powerful to give kids that language to say, I don't like what you're doing. And I would suggest anytime you can give kids a choice, to give them a choice. So, or adults. Like, I don't like being told what to do. So if you have kids that, you know, think about what your goal is and think about what you can accommodate to have them reach that goal. So if you need them to walk upstairs, I don't know, PT is, anyone want to be a PT? My son's working with a PT right now, so... if you want, I don't know what your goals would be, walk upstairs, is that a good one? Alternating feet, walking upstairs. You want to put something motivating at the top of the stairs, I would think, right? Like, you just don't want to be like, walk up and down the stairs, walk up and down the stairs. Like, it's, why? Like, why am I walking up and down stairs? So you want to make it functional and motivating. And if it's not, and they say that they don't like it, I would change something, because I don't like being told what to do, or... I don't really see the need to tell kids that they have to do something that is pointless. You want to make it motivating to them and give them a reason. So in my, we'll see how this works out, but in my house, we only have rules if I can tell you why that it's a rule. It's not just because I said so, which probably will change at some point, but right now it's, you know, I have to explain why we have a rule. Any other questions, guys? Yeah.
So I had two things. The first thing was about exclusion. My little sister, she's 11, she has Down syndrome, and my parents have like pushed for inclusion like crazy. And over the last few years, like, we've noticed such a difference in her, like, just like throughout a range of things, like socially, like just her speech, everything. It's just honestly insane how much she has like benefited from inclusion. So much.
Awesome. That's
and then the second thing was about like when you're in a session with a child and say their parent, do you find that sometimes the parent can be like a distraction, or do you find that like they benefit from the parent?
So I'm still learning how to deal with that. Absolutely, parents can be a distraction.
When you said that, I was kind of like, huh, I wonder how
you have to really, it's helped me, so I wasn't a parent until very recently. It has helped me to have become a parent, because I do the same things that they're doing sometimes, and I'm like, oh, I get it. Like, it's hard, like, your kid is a reflection of you in some way, and so when you're in the room, like, my niece, I could be in a room with all day long, let her fail, I can just, like, I'd be like, yeah, she knows this word, whatever. Like, I was great in a room when she was being tested for EI. When my son was being tested for EI, I'm like, he could do that. He does that all the time. And I'm like, oh my goodness, I'm that person that I've worked with. You have to get good at coaching. So that's a skill in and of itself, separate from being a therapist, is being like a consultant or a coach. You have to be, and I'm still getting comfortable with this, telling parents to stop and change what they're doing. It's hard. It's hard to say you're parenting. Well, and they're not, and you wanna go at it really, you know, with a lot of empathy and slowly at their pace. Like, you have to treat them like your second client because it's the family that's your client. When you're working with parents and kids in the same room. But it has its own set of challenges. It's a really great question. So I just kind of consider that group as a client. And you learn at their pace, with their cultural preferences. You'll get all this in school, and you don't know what to do with it until you get in the room with that parent, and you're like, oh, goodness. So when you can, you give constructive feedback. So like the compliment sandwich. So like, you're doing this really well. You need to stop jumping in and telling your kid to look at the at question one again. But I noticed that you did this thing really well. So, like, you know, you try to be really positive and see all that. But, yeah, it's a skill you will learn. But I think it's really important. Because if they don't change what they're doing, then it's going to be really hard for that, you know, child to be able to grow in all the environments that they're in. And that's really cool about inclusion is just fabulous. And it's not that hard. It's just a mindset change. And for some students, you do need some more supports. Like, it depends on, you know, what we're talking about. But 99.9% of kids, no matter what their ability level, can be in a classroom with typical peers. It's not a, that big a challenge, I don't think. So, I'm sorry.
So I currently work at a daycare, and I think I've noticed a lot more communication, like, styles throughout, like, the children, because I've seen them since 6 months old to right now.
Yeah, that's cool.
So, oh, yeah. But have you, one of the girls that I'm particularly thinking about, she just turned 2 in September, and we can't tell if she has, like, a delay or she's just stubborn, because sometimes she'll say, like, these full sentences, and I'm like, who just said that? But then sometimes I think she understands what she's saying, what we're saying to her, and she knows what she wants to say, but her language and speech aren't, like, working together. So have you worked with people that are stubborn and then notice that they can have the speech with the right supports, or, like, how...
Yeah, so temperament's a thing that is tough. So that's absolutely real. So there are kids that, if you look up temperament, it's genetic. In a way, so you're not changing certain things. Stubborn kids are going to be stubborn. Shy kids are going to be shy. It isn't a barrier completely. It's just something you have to work with. But I will say, if you have to figure out what's motivating her to communicate, and that's challenging. So I would also say that speaking is not the only way kids communicate. It's not the primary way kids communicate. So you want to notice all those little things that are being communicated non-verbally, and like, if they're just sitting there, what's going to motivate them? So I had a little boy who was non-verbal. I mean, I swore up and I was like, this child has no words. I've never heard a word. The teacher never heard a word. Mom insisted that the child was speaking in full sentences, and I'm like, maybe. I'm like, just don't, they're not. And finally, so I did the whole total communication thing, pictures, whatever. He liked sign language. He was one of the few kids I worked with who really took to sign. And he started signing more my turn. He really liked this toy with a, you hammer a ball through a hole, and it was like a ramp. And I would just make him sign more my turn with other students. And in like 2 weeks, he was talking in full sentences, and I'm like, what is, I don't know what happened. Like, sometimes you're just like, okay, I don't know. But we found, I feel like part of it is, especially for kids on the spectrum, not to go back to that, but for a lot of students, anxiety plays a role. So, like, and it might not be for her, she might be stubborn, but anxiety plays a huge role, I think, in a lot of kids' communication issues, especially if they've had trouble. So, like, if you were learning something new and you just, like, are brand new to a country, or, you know, and we have a lot of bilingual students who that is, you know, happening also, there's some anxiety around speaking and being put on the spot and putting demand. Like, think about when she is and isn't using those sentences. Like, is it when you put a demand on her? Because maybe she just doesn't want to, you know, she's just shutting down. Finding out what motivates those kids and then taking some of the pressure off, I find is a good combination. So, like, really, really motivating and low pressure situations, you're going to see what the kids can do more, much more than, you know, what is the answer to this question? Like, if I put you up here, if I took any of you and were like, okay, I'm going to quiz you now on, you know, your profession or whatever, you probably wouldn't perform as well as if I just went and worked with you in the gym in your natural setting where you're comfortable. You could probably show me a lot. You guys have a lot of skills, I'm sure, but, you know, you might not be able to demonstrate that on the spot. Yeah, that's what I would suggest, but it's tough. It's a challenge. Anybody else? Stories, questions?
Yeah, I've been working with a child for a few months, and she has a seizure disorder. Mm-hmm. And for the first few months, she was nonverbal. She didn't speak when we were working together. But whenever we were working together, we were in a large group. And one of the times, we like got separated from the group, and she started using her words and talking. So I found when we're in a large group, she won't use her words, but when it's just like one-on-one, she'll communicate.
That's really cool. So there's a couple of things about that. So I've worked with students with selective mutism, which is a thing. And it's not necessarily what she's doing, because I've spent a long time not speaking in large groups. I'm not a big fan. But some children do have selective mutism, and they can't. They can't speak in a group. They can't speak if they're anxious. Like, that's real. And I don't know how skilled a communicator she is in a one-on-one setting, but if you can find a way for her, I'd start out in a small group. Like, if I were going to tell you how to get her to communicate in a large group, that might not be her goal right now, because you don't always have to, you know, we don't ask functionally a lot of people to communicate in large groups. So there's some research out there. So I don't know if you do circle time or how old this child is. Is she?
It's a cheerleading practice. She's 3.
Oh, okay. So yeah, so she's right around that age where they do stuff like circle time. There's a lot of research out there that circle times are not really age appropriate for 3 to 5. 3 to 5 year olds, my niece is 2. She speaks in like 8 and 9 word sentences. She's crazy. Her language skills are great. You put her in a large group, she's not saying a word. She's just, it's like, it's scary for them. And I feel like a lot of adults are like that too. We don't ask a lot of people in situations outside of a school setting to like participate in big group activities where they're talking. Except if you're up doing a presentation. But like, not all of you will have to do this all the time. Like, that's a rare event outside of a school setting. So it's an interesting skill that we're making kids do at a really young age. So maybe she doesn't need to talk in a large group. Maybe just a small group school. That would be my suggestion on that. Anybody else work with multiple disabilities? Yeah.
Well, my kid, he's 12. He will only like talk when we're one-on-one. So like, if like one of the pro staff comes over, he won't speak to them, or he will a little bit maybe. But also, he when he doesn't want to respond, he'll say Steve or Jeff. That's our goal. Just keep talking. But I'm just curious if you like if there's like an explanation for that.
I don't know. Maybe he'll tell me someday. Does he have a diagnosis of it, or is he like?
He has PBNH.
Oh, okay. Okay. I couldn't tell you what that stands for, but I've heard of it. That's interesting. That's cool.
Yeah, I kind of roll with it.
Yeah, I don't know. So what are you working on with him? Like, are
well,
you
doing like more like motor skills?
Okay. So yeah, I roll with it. Maybe as your, you know, exit, because you have a good rapport with him. So let him talk to Steve when he's not doesn't want to talk. That is interesting. I'd love to ask, like, I wonder what he'd say if he just said, like, so who's Steve, or Jeff, or whoever.
Tell me.
Yeah. But if, you know, your goals, if you're getting to work on them, and you've got a good rapport, I agree with it.
Yeah.
Some people are just great, you know. That's okay. Yeah, Izzy.
I work with a girl who's 10 now, but she was nonverbal till she was like 5 or 6.
Yeah.
But she would always watch like YouTube videos, and they would talk with like English accents or British accents. And then like one day it just hit her, and she started like spewing out sentences and could tell you everything she wanted. But like up until now, she talks with an accent. And her mom always asks me if it's gonna go away, and like I don't know what to tell you. Like it's not the worst thing in the world because she still communicates, but
so does she.
She has like a literal British accent, and you don't really get it.
So how are her sentences? Is she
like, she's really, really animated, which I feel like also matches the video. Like she almost
talks. I'm wondering
talks
if she's pulling literal sentences from the videos and using them to communicate.
I don't know, but she always asks me if it's gonna go away, and I don't know what to tell her.
I
it's
don't
cute,
either.
It's definitely.
I would doubt. I mean,
it's cool, but really she hears like everyone else talk. I feel like she hears like her input is more us and everyone around her compared to the videos she watches in like her free time. But
how old is she now? So she's 10.
She's 10 now,
and she's been talking with
the
British accent since she was 5.
It's so it's cute and it's cool, but it like
that's
throws a lot of people off.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, you've stumped me. I have
right.
no idea if it'll go away. I'd love to know. Try to follow up and see if it goes away. That's interesting. So there's research, and I don't know if she has a diagnosis of autism.
She does.
Okay. So there is research that kids on the spectrum, they did a study with kids on the spectrum who have parents from different countries who had accents, essentially.
Yeah.
And so they tended to have the accent of their mother. Whereas kids who weren't on the spectrum, like let's say your mother's from England and you move here before, you know, before you're born, your mom moves here and you're born here, most kids will have accents from here where they live.
Okay.
Kids on the spectrum tend to pick up their mother's accent for some reason.
There's a lot of like female voices, I feel like, more often than male.
Right, and they're probably spending more time with their mothers and they're not good socially, so they're not getting that input as much, so they're picking up that accent. So if she picked up her language skills from YouTube, from British person on YouTube,
so
that might be the explanation for that. Interesting. I don't know. I never read whether those accents go away. I just know that the kids have the accent of their mother rather than the culture that they grew up in.
Yeah.
But that is an interesting one. I would think.
I mean, at least she's talking, so we're not.
It might
like,
fade.
Bummed out about.
Yeah,
it.
Great.
It's just,
well.
Quirky,
you know? Yeah, and I use scripting, so a lot of kids who have autism will script, so they'll say, like, I had one little girl who liked brown bear, so she'd recite it, and so she'd, like, brown bear, what do you see? And that's what she did, and so we just kind of embedded stuff in the brown bear script, so she'd go, brown bear, what do you see? And then she'd do the sign for I want, and then she'd put the word for whatever she wanted, brown bear, what do you see? Bubbles, like so she'd do this, and that's kind of how she asked for stuff, and so you know eventually we were working beyond that, but it's a way to communicate. I'm cool with it if it works. So that was that. That's interesting. Yeah.
So the girl I work with, she says like all done a lot.
She probably had early intervention.
Yes.
Is my guess.
is there something that you would suggest, like, communicating, like, while we're doing an activity? Because you can't just stop every time she says
So she's doing it for when she needs a break.
Kind of, but she kind of just says it, like, she'll just go
she's
through.
She's not functionally saying it. Does she want to stop the activity?
Sure.
Yeah.
Like, we could be, like, just walking across the gym, and she'll just say, all done, all done.
Yeah, I doubt. You can do some experimenting and see. If you said, oh, you're all done and stopped walking, like, what would she do? Like, would she keep walking? Like, you can kind of test it and see. I doubt she's using that functionally if she's just saying it kind of at random.
Yeah.
But you can try it. Like, I would do some kind of test and see, like, oh, okay, we're all done, and stop and see what she does.
She also does, like, a lot of things for, like, attention.
Yeah.
Essentially. Like, she'll do, like, a fake sneeze and then say, bless you to herself. Like, so.
So that's probably in conjunction with the communication piece of that is a behavior piece, right? So she's doing stuff for attention. So there's ways to train those behaviors out, like replace them essentially. So you want to replace that with a more acceptable behavior or less weird behavior or whatever. but you need to figure out the function of it. So if it's for attention, you start giving her attention for things that you prefer her to be doing rather than that. And you kind of ignore that. If it's for attention, you ignore, typically, if it works, you know. And there's behavior specialists that I consult with those kind of behaviors where you're like, I don't know how to fix this and I want to, because it's getting in the way of communicating or it's getting in the way of her participating in something. The all done thing might be because if you don't want to ignore every time she says all done, like if it is functional, but you don't want to just stop what you're doing every time she says it. So I kind of got to figure out, your first step would be figure out why she's doing it. And then if it's for attention, you do have to ignore it and then replace it with, you know, if it's because she's all done, sometimes I do a break. So if you say, we're walking across the gym, she says, all done, and you just went, okay, we're all done, and stopped walking, and she stood there and, like, sat down, like, maybe she was tired, then you could set a time, like, you could start doing things like, oh, okay, we'll take a break, and you could replace the all done with, like, let's take a break. I do that a lot. Like, oh, you need a break, you set a timer for a minute, you took a minute break, and you're acknowledging, so it's important to acknowledge communicative intent, but you can't always just stop doing what you're doing, or, you know, if a kid wants cookies for dinner, you know, you're not going to give them everything they want, but you have to acknowledge that they said, you know, I know you want cookies, but we have carrots, like, sorry. So those are the kind of things I'd work in, but yeah, that's interesting. It's kind of an interesting one, but I guess she learned a phrase from EI, and she's probably not using it functionally. So I try to replace it with something functional. And if it's a script, you might have to give her a different way of saying all done and just ignore it when she says that phrase. So like, if she is all done, give her something else to say so people know when she really is all done. And then if all done is something she says, that's fine, I guess.
Okay.
Yeah. But you know, definitely talk to peers who are communication people and behavior people, and she'll get there. Figure out a plan. So I don't know what how much time we have, but if anyone else has any questions or comments. You guys do cool stuff. Congratulations. This is a neat program. So are we at, I don't know what time
is it?
It's 9:05.
9:05? I think so.
Okay, you're all done. Thanks, guys. Oh, thank you. I was going to comment about your shirt. Thank you.
Oh, yay.